Hello, Keith Kelly here from Jumpers for Goalposts, and welcome to episode 3 of Slip Disc, a show produced by Mick Nolan and digitaldub.ie. It's a simple format where we give our guests the opportunity to pick 3 songs that might spark a happy event or memory in their lives, and we go on a journey with them. I'm delighted to say that today's guest is none other than Gerry. Stay tuned. Hello, Gerry Adams, and thank you for giving us some of your time.
Thank you, Keith Kelly. Imagine my dad. Are you well?
I'm not bad, and you?
I'm good. Yeah, thank
you. So
God.
I suppose, look, before we get started, Gerry, could you give me some sort of an idea of how you unwind at the minute, or what excites you in life at the minute?
Oh, jeepers. I've always found the very simple things excite me. You know, a bit of crack, a bit of slagging with, a bit of banter with friends, being out in the elements, kids messing, dog, good bit of music, nice bit of music, you know, depends what you mean by excite. No.
What lights your fire? You know what I mean. What gets you going? You know.
Well, sometimes I find if I get a really good walk. Now I mean a good, you know.
Yeah.
Cross country 5-6-7 mile walk. If I'm up on a hill, I come down on a sort of a high. You know, you get rid of all your tensions, pressure, you've just been absorbed. If you're going uphill, you actually have to concentrate on what you're doing in case you slip or, you know, so you're totally absorbed in what you're at. And then nature, you know, this time of the year, especially like with the choir stretch in the mornings and the choir stretch in the evenings, the birds are up early, you know, so all of that. A good game of football, good game of hurling. I mean, I shout at the television when I'm watching much for the day or whatever happens to be the particular program. So just the normal everyday things that would. Now I'm talking about good excitement here. You know,
I
would get agitated by, you know, stories in the news like the last week's revelations about the mother and baby homes, when you hear about homeless people down on the streets, you know, all the nonsense that's going on with Brexit at the moment, the dreadfulness of hearing about, you know, every evening the figures of people down from the COVID. But, you know, good excitement is just a very, very natural. Enjoying life, living every moment. I'm a very, very firm believer in living in the moment. A friend of mine calls it the nowness. Living in the nowness, living. You know, you can't undo yesterday, and tomorrow isn't here yet. So, you know, don't waste today. This could be your last day. So get the most out of it.
So just on when you were saying, you know, the stuff that's going on recently is irritating. Are you a good man at sort of switching off the telly or switching off the radio and had enough for today?
I don't watch the TV that much, to tell you the truth. If fire ones were about the house, like it would be on constantly. If I'm here on my own, I just put it on to watch something. And when I watch what I want to watch, I turn it off again. I do listen to the radio a lot. Might have a preference for the radio, just in terms of having it there in the background, and it nearly provokes you. You have to think, you know, because you have to imagine if you're listening to something. And I play a lot of music. You know, I don't play any instruments, but you know, I would play iPod, CD, just all the time. That would be a backdrop of, I don't think I would have the same quality of life if there wasn't music. And I think music is magical for lifting your mood, or for, you know, moving you to tears, or moving you to joy, or just boosting you, making you dance. You know, music's just terrific.
Absolutely. I often say to people, I facilitate a mental health program, and, you know, I often say to them, one of the tricks or tools I use, you know, if I have, a chore of doing the hoovering, which would, like you, probably irritate me, you know, just do the hoover. But I find if I switch on some music, it nearly turns me, you know, that video of Freddie Mercury going around with it. Now I don't get dressed up. Yeah. But, you know, it gets me moving about, and it becomes less of a chore then. The music just brings me somewhere. And so, yeah, music can do all sorts. It's a magical thing, isn't it, music?
What do you do when you're washing the dishes or making the beds?
Oh, well, I listen to a bit of The Clash or something, you know. it just makes it that so much easier. So talking about music, Gerry, we're going to dip into your first song that you picked. By the way, how did you find picking three songs before we get started? Is it difficult enough process?
Well, you see, first of all, sometimes you're asked to pick, you know, your five favourite songs or your three favourite songs. I did an iPod with Davey Fury there last week. It's impossible to pick your five favourite songs. So you asked me to pick three songs. You know, and I, you know, I could have picked Springsteen, I could have picked Woody Guthrie, Connie Francis, Doris Day.
We were thinking a bit of Leonard Cohen, probably.
Well, Cohen as well, yeah, I'm a big fan of Leonard Cohen's. But then I thought to myself in this, that I would pick music that perhaps people don't hear every day. So it just struck me, rather than just pick, you know, what I like, and obviously the songs or the music that I picked, I do like. But that was the notional idea, you know, to pick something you wouldn't always hear on RTE.
Okay. So your first song that you picked is by Mary Black, and it's a song for Ireland. So we'll give that a listen, Jerry. So, Gerry,
there you go.
Boy, that song.
Well, first of all, Luke Kelly sings a wonderful version of that song as well. His rendition is, like most of Luke's stuff, is really spectacular. But I'm involved with a community arts festival here. It's actually the largest community fela or festival in Ireland and in Europe. And way back in the day, Mary Black played. Okay. And the a lot of these concerts and plays and sessions were held, you know, in the local parish hall, or in this case in the leisure center. And it always stayed in my head that when she sang that song, every time she sang, I sang a song for Ireland, the audience applauded. It was quite, amazing. And that, she told me afterwards that was the first time she had that experience, and she found it very emotional.
Jeez.
You know, that she was singing, and then when she got to that sort of line, the audience. But so it's a great song. She sings it wonderfully well, and you know, it has everything in it. You know, the west of Ireland, wondering about the place, having a jar, you know, a bit of fishing, and then you know, it's post conflict, if you like, and that it's pointing towards the future that. That no one else will have to fight. So it's just a terrific anthem, and hopefully your listeners will enjoy it.
Yeah, well, when I got word that was one of your songs, you know, I checked it out on YouTube. Obviously, I knew the song, but I checked it out on YouTube, and it was all, as you say, there's all different versions of it, but the one that came up, and maybe that was a video, and it was like a drone going around the West Coast. It was powerful image, along with the song. It's really good because I learned visually, so that gives me a better knowledge of what the song is about, you know, sort of way.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, very good. Yeah.
So if we could dip back, sort of rewind an awful lot, Gerry, back to maybe your childhood, could you tell me what was it like for a kid growing up in the streets Belfast, and did you play street soccer like I did as a kid?
Yeah, we played street soccer. Where I grew up was in the Falls on a street called Upper Corn Street North.
Okay.
And the area, the nearest equivalent of it I can think of at the moment would be the Liberties. Small houses, you know, two bedrooms, no inside toilet, a scullery out the back, and a top in the backyard, and small lines of terraced houses. So we played football, soccer, a lot of the time with papers rolled up into a sock, with, I suppose, I heard some people referring to it as a sock ball. We played handball against the Gables. We played Rallyo, Kick the Tin. There were swings put up on, there were old gas lights. There were swings put up on the lampposts, mostly girls, but not exclusively girls. And we rumbled and ran and skipped and messed and hurt ourselves and did all the things that that you would expect. And we played street hurling. A cousin of mine, second cousin of mine, older than me, Jared Bagley, introduced me to hurling. Jared was a great hurler, and another guy called Paddy Elliott. They were maybe 5 or 6, 7 years older, but that's a big difference when you're six or seven or eight or nine.
Yeah.
And then I went to the local school, St. Finian's, and the Christian Brothers brought us hurling. We walked from there. I always remember it's we were told that it's 1 mile exactly from the gate of St. Finian's to the first gate of the Falls Park. So our team or our panel would have walked from St. Finian's with the hurdles up to the Falls Park, trained, and then walked back down again. You know? So we spent a lot of time in the streets. You know?
Okay, so it was exciting times as a kid being out. It's the same as myself and my community. It was a good, strong community sense.
Oh, absolutely. Actually, I was staying with my granny at that time.
Okay.
When I was in Upper Corn Street, and I stayed with my granny off and on afterwards. It was, you're probably the same practice there. It wasn't unusual, particularly in a big family.
Yeah.
You were nearly fostered out to your granny. My sister Margaret stayed with my other granny, who lived quite close, my granny Hannaway, who lived quite close. And then we got a house in Ballymurphy. And I was starting to head up into, you know, being 12, 11, 12, 13, 14, and so on. But it was just an extension. It was the same games. The difference being, Ballymurphy is on the slopes of the Black Mountain. So in the summer, we lived on the mountain. We were like wild things on the mountain. Just every single day, we disappeared, hiking up the mountain, bringing up, you know, jam pieces and bottles of water, and chasing and running and building little huts and so on. So it was, but I have to say, like, I had an idyllic childhood, and it is a fact that we were poor. In fact, we were very poor, but so was everybody else, and nobody really knew the difference. Now, maybe those who were trying to feed us or educate us and so on knew the difference, but as kids, we just all roughed it out and roughed it in. And generally speaking, even though there was tragedy, you know, a neighbour may have been killed in an accident, somebody's father died, it didn't impede an awful lot in my childhood memories anyway.
Okay. So we had a guest on earlier in the series, Paul Howard. I don't know if you'd be aware of Paul Howard. But,
Yeah,
well, he told a story that his parents moved to London in the mid-60s. And by the time Paul was 8, his father had always said that if Thatcher got into power, they were moving straight back to Dublin. He came home the day Thatcher came into power. Paul did from school. He was 8 years of age, and he seen his mother packing up all the bags and all the stuff, and it was on to the ferry back home. But he remarked that when he was living in London as a kid, he regarded himself as very much Irish. His upbringing was Irish, you know. But it wasn't until he arrived in Monkstown and then in school in Ballybrack that he suddenly dawned on him that he was very much English to all these other school kids in 1980. And there was a bit of bullying going on, you know, remarks like Brits out and all this sort of stuff. So when did you, Gerry, as a kid, become aware of the sort of volatile, sectarian nature of the city you lived in?
Well, first of all, I also had the experience of always knowing that I was Irish. It was just in the rearing, if you like. There was only a very limited amount of Irish language spoken at home. My mother would have had a couple of fuckle. We went to the Gaeltacht in Donegal on scholarship in the summer with the rest of the boys out of the school I was at. While there may have been an interest in soccer, and we played street soccer, you know, the big game was hurling, Gaelic football, local GAA club, and so on. So I was always very conscious of that. And in fact, I remember when I was about maybe 16 or so, having to fill in a form for some reason. And it said British subject, and I was sort of a bit
taken aback,
perplexed by that. I remember actually asking my mother about it. But I come from a Republican family, and both my maternal and paternal grandparents and great grandparents had an involvement in the labor movement and in the Republican movement. My uncles, my father. My uncles on both sides of the family all ended up at different times in prison, on a prison ship at one point in Belfast prison. They were all imprisoned in the 70s, but I'm talking here about the 30s and the 20s.
But
I have to say, I wasn't certainly in my up until my teens very conscious of that side of my family history or that side of the politics. The first time I confronted sectarianism was when I was challenged by other boys. I was down at the bottom of Divis Street, and they asked me, was I a Catholic or a Protestant? And they, you know, they got round me to, they asked me to say, the Hail Mary or the Our Father or something to prove whatever they were wanting to prove. My first real sort of life-changing moment, if you like, was in 1964. I would have been 15 or 16, and there was an election, and the Sinn Féin party was banned at the time, and the Irish Act was the main piece of coercive legislation by which this place was, I suppose, suppressed. And, you know, you could be arrested without charge or trial. You could be detained. Newspapers, books, emblems, badges were banned. An assembly of three people could be declared unlawful just by a police officer. But anyway, the Republicans decided to contest the election, and they had an election office and a shop on my way to school. And they put the Irish flag, the national flag, in the window of the shop, and they put up the photographs of their candidates and so on. And Ian Paisley, who was then an up-and-coming demagogue, threatened to march into Davis Street and to take the flag down unless the IUC did it. So the IUC did it. They came in, okay, broke the windows. And we're wandering up and down, 15-year-olds wandering up and down to school. There's about 3 or 4 days of civil disorder. I wandered after that down into the government publishing office, and I bought for, you know, a shilling or something or less, a copy of the Special Powers Act. And because I was wondering how could all this happen? How could, because the area was basically put under martial law for those 3 or 4 or 5 days. I mean, what the Republicans did when the IUC took the flag out of the window, they went and got another flag and put it back again. So the IUC came back in again. So that first excited my curiosity about politics. That was my first taste of it. I talked about going to the Gaeltacht. I remember when we were going to the Gaeltacht, one of the things that excited us on the bus up was we wanted to see the border. When we got up, there was no border, so we were all disappointed that we couldn't see the border. But anyway.
So was Gerry Adams, were you an interested student in school? Did school grab your attention, or were you acting a maggot, or...?
No, I was mediocre enough. I had a great love and still have a great love of reading. And my granny embedded that in me. She was a tiny little woman, and she had been widowed quite young, and she'd reared a family mostly of sons. And she had been what they called a part-timer or a half-timer. That is, she worked in the mills one day, went to school the next day, worked in the mills the next day. This is when she was 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. But she could write and read, and one of her daily visits was up to the Falls Library, and I was in tow. And of course, that introduced me to the world of books. And I was the only member of my family that wore glasses. And that is because I used to read at night with the light of the lamppost outside the house. And I became a voracious reader. But I wasn't, you know, I failed my 11 plus. The 11 plus is a really desperate test that kids have to go through at the age of 11. And it really marks out their... I could actually mark out their life journey, but it certainly marks out their academic life journey. So I failed it the first time, and I'd done it a year earlier, so I got a second go, and I got it the second time. And I went from, I went to St. Mary's Grammar School, but I have to say a lot of it was wasted on me. You know, I obviously I learned a lot of things, and no doubt I'm influenced yet by what I learned, but you know, I did about 3 or 4 years of Latin, and The only thing I can remember is Amo, Amas, Amat. I can't remember anything else from
Latin. So was it a, you know, you didn't really have much interest. Was it a struggle in the mornings yourself saying, oh, geez, I'm going in here again? Or did you have a different mindset as to, no, this is what I have to do?
I only went on the beak once. Myself and a friend of mine, Joe McGee, we both went in the beak. He was in Derbyshire, but we found it very boring. You know, we were wandering around. So no, it wasn't a matter of not being motivated to go to school. I think I was, apart from that one exception, I was diligent enough about that. But see, the 64, so I'm 15, 16. 66 is the 50th anniversary of 1916. So there's a huge celebration of that. And, you know, RTE, we didn't have a television, and we wouldn't have got RTE anyway, even if we had a television. But, you know, they did a special series on it. There were books produced. A lot of the readings of the leaders, particularly Connolly and Pierce, were reproduced. And there was a big pageant in Crook Park, and there was a pageant here in Casement Park, which was banned, by the way. The authorities here suspended the train from coming up from Dublin on the basis there was going to be an IRA uprising, and they mobilised the B specials and the C specials, and they banned the Easter parade, which went ahead and which was a huge event. So I'm at school against this backcloth. Both of a resurgence of republicanism, but also those individuals mostly are small groups who had been trying to expose discrimination in jobs, in housing, the draconian nature of a lot of the legislation that was in place, that they all merged into the Civil Rights Association, the Northern Ireland, Ireland Civil Rights Association. So that was the background. So, and I was getting myself increasingly involved in this stuff, and therefore it isn't so much that I was disinterested in school, but that I had other interests. And then eventually I just dropped out of school. It must have been in 1967, maybe going into 1968, but certainly I would imagine 1967. No, I may have been before that. I may have been, because I think I was working. I saw an advertisement for a job as a barman, an apprentice barman, and I just went and applied for on a whim. My parents, I have to say, were very disappointed at me.
I'm just asking you, like, was there any ideas in your house of maybe wanting someone to get a trade or something like that, you know?
The ethos behind St. Mary's Grammar School, and there's a sense to this, is that become very well educated and become the lawyers, the accountants, the priests, if need be, but that was the sort of the thinking within the Catholic movement at that time. And I bump into people nowadays who I was at school with, and you know, and that's what they are. Some went on to be judges, to be barristers, to be architects, to be accountants, to be writers, to be very successful. Many of them, I'm sure there were. There were failures as well along the way, so that was the ethos. So even if I had stayed at school, it wouldn't have been to be a plumber or a joiner. The background in my family, and my brother Paddy nearly became a plumber. So I dropped out. If I had stayed at it and had got the exams, I probably might have ended up teaching or something if I had been lucky enough to qualify properly.
And is it a thing where because I suppose when I was going to school, like yourself, I dropped out early. I didn't really have much interest in academia at the time. But I would still have a lot of friends from that time who I would still probably knock about with. Would you be similar, or did you lose touch?
I would occasionally say I'm a bit older than you, so I
could be
a lot of my friends are dying or dead. Okay. Now there's still plenty of them left, of course, but once you get involved in the Republican struggle, as I got involved in, and then that becomes your life.
Okay.
So a lot, while I have friends outside of that circle, my closest friends, the ones I see most often, and, you know, I actually believe in friendship. I think friendship is one of the most important things in life. And I think that friendship should be above politics, above, you know, you should retain your friendships. It doesn't, you know, it's not, you know, it's too important. So most of my close friends would be people that I spent years in prison with, or people that I spent decades in struggle with. As I say, I do have friends outside of that, and we'll meet up occasionally. We'll go to a football game or a hurling game or something and have the crack, and there'd be no talk of politics. It'll just be fun and banter, you know.
So, right, we're going to move on to your second piece of music, Gerry, which is The Rose and Me by Christy Moore.
Listen for a while, now I'll tell you the story. How I fell in love with the Rose of Tralee. It was about 5 o'clock in the morning, ladies and gentlemen. I was only after getting off the boat. I was walking down the north wall, minding my own business with my suitcase under my arm, sitting down every minute till a voice behind me went, "Hello, hello, hello. Where do you think you were going at this hour in the morning?" I turned around, ladies and gentlemen, and who do you think was standing behind me? Only the Rose of Tralee. And she wearing a grand new blue Bangardese uniform. I thought she was a chief super. "Hey, Rose, how was it going?" "The last time I saw you was upstairs in the tent, down below in the dome, with Gabo and the pretty poly tights and all the beauty queens."
That's a cracking tune, isn't it? Yeah.
I'm a big Christy fan, and I picked that one because it doesn't get much play, and because it's humorous, and he observes life. You know, that's famously about a band Garda won the Rose of Tralee. You know, so he tells of their adventure, and it's a very wry commentary on Irish society as it was at that time. No, he's a mighty man, Christy, you know, for songs of passion and struggle and liberation and social justice, but also just funny songs like that, really, you know.
It's
a very long song. It's a very long song.
It's 13 minutes long, but it's not something you switch off, you know. He has a great gift. There's a great friend of mine, Graham Merrigan, and he's always encouraged me to listen to more Christy, and I do dip in and I do enjoy it, but then I dip back out. And he's a great man, because I suppose a song is about telling a story, isn't it? And bringing you to that place, I suppose, and he can do it magically, can't he?
He's one of the best people. He's one of the best people for a live concert. He's really terrific. I mean, Springsteen. I've been looking up to go to his concerts in Ireland. I went to all of Leonard Cohen's recent concerts in Ireland. I was lucky enough to be at Kilmainham and up at Sligo, up at Lissadale as well. But there's crack with Christy in a concert, and he can move the crowd from tears to laughter to just stomping their feet and having the crack. So, you know, he's a wonderful storyteller, wonderful library of songs, you know, just it's amazing.
And I think someone now, again, he wouldn't be really on my radar, but again, he would be on Merrill's, seems to have that same gift of manoeuvring the crowd in Damien Dempsey. Are you familiar with Damien Dempsey?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm a big fan of Damien's as well.
Yeah, yeah. He seems to have that gift of, you know, creating a buzz in the crowd.
Well, there is something special about a live concert with artists or musicians who interact with the audience.
Yeah.
So it becomes a gig, and then you discover that the performers are enjoying themselves as well as the people there. You know? And we get praised all the time as being the very, very best of audience. Now, I don't know if that's just our idea of ourselves. We have a rather
romanticized
sense of ourselves, which is good. It's one of our more positive characteristics. But an odd time you'd be watching TV and the likes of Don McLean or some of these very famous performers would be on, and they'd sing a song and the audience would start to sing it back at them. And I think that's magical, and it must be magical for the, like, I mean, the Women's Heart Tour, I was watching it on television there recently, where they look back on that famous moment where the Woman's Heart, the Eleanor McAvoy song. And to see the audience picking up on that and singing that back to them, to the women who were on the stage singing, it's amazing. It's a lovely, I was trying to figure this out. I remember listening to Christy one time, and I forget what the song was, but he was asked to sing a song, and he said, "The air in the room has to be just right for that song."
There you go.
And I heard Shane McGowan said, you know, the reason that they're called ours, because somebody was praising them for writing so much good music. And he said, the reason that they're called ours, he said, is that they're floating about there. They're just floating about in the air. And he said, the likes of me just catches it. And if it didn't, sure Paul Simon or somebody else would get it. So it's not better me getting it. So there's something magical, there's something in that. You know, and I would watch it. We were talking about television. I would watch, probably as a matter of preference, T.G. Cahir, both to keep my own Irish leafa, but also because they do programs that others don't do. And I think it's absolutely amazing. You will see what are obviously very, very ordinary people, mostly from rural Ireland, but not exclusively, who are going about their business, working in a kitchen, working on a farm, labouring on the side of the road. And then they go and get a banjo or an accordion or a bosca-kyole guitar, and they'll start playing music. Some of it's 100 years old. And then when they come to talk about it, they talk about it with such authority and such knowledge. And for me, that's just absolutely amazing that we can have this reservoir of culture. And it isn't just ancient tunes, although I think there's something special about that, but they're also making their own music. You know, you look at what Sharon Shannon's doing, you know, with music and meshing it and mixing it with all sorts of other influences and cultures. And so on. So I think that there's nothing like a session. And one of the things that it's probably the same there when you were growing up was that regularly people would have a sing song. On a Saturday night, they come home from the pub, eat the Sunday soup, bring in a few bottles of stout as it was then, and brown paper bags, and somebody would call somebody for a song. You know, one singer, one song, you know, be a bit of Cunis, Cunis, you know.
would you give an old tune yourself, Gerry?
I was teasing, I was slagging that I gave up a very lucrative musical career for the Republican struggle. So if I get space, Annie, I've I know very few songs the whole way through. I probably have hundreds of songs, but only one sentence or two sentences of them. And everybody around me tells me I can't sing, but I refuse to accept that. I sing away from the stage.
And you know what, I can relate to that, and I'm always envious of friends of mine. If you know, back in the day, if you were at a session, I thought, how can they know? Now, I'd know the song, but I wouldn't be able, if someone said, well, are you singing? Like you're saying, two lines, and then I'd be stumbling. I'm always envious when I see my mates on the guitar, because I tried it a few times, and possibly didn't give it enough time, and you want to play something straight away, you know, initially, but it doesn't work like that, obviously. So have you ever tried to play an instrument yourself, or have you ever got a chance?
Tin whistle, but I never got by, you know, three blind mice. I never got as far as the Belfast hornpipe or the Siege of Venice or anything else. I mean, there's a guitar here behind me that the kids play every so often, but no, the only thing I play is the record player.
Okay, yeah, a bit like myself, yeah. Safer that way, isn't it? So would there be any sort of one, have you ever been to Glastonbury or anything like that, any big festivals?
No, Flacule here, the big fela that we have here has a big music component to it, and we're blessed. I mean, the fela in West Belfast came, if you recall, after three IRA volunteers were killed at Gibraltar. And then there was that long period of bringing their bodies home, and then their funerals were attacked. Then other people were killed, and then two British soldiers were killed. And the media and the establishment, which had been beating up, I was the MP of West Belfast at the time, which had been beating up on the people of West Belfast anyway, we were subjected to it. A dreadful campaign of vilification, and this place was an open air prison. We were surrounded by forts and observation posts and British Army dugouts and helicopters and armored vehicles, all the rest of it. But anyway, they described us as a terrorist community, and we said, "Here, hold on, we're not the terrorist community." So we brought together, I was one of the instigators, we brought together a meeting of people who were involved just in creative activities in the arts and music and poetry and painting and photography and football and all the rest of it. And we put on a fela, but we also invited in people from outside to show solidarity with us. And I have to say, they were exemplary, the people who came and to show their plays, to give their lectures, to play their music, to show their exhibitions, to talk about their books. So there was a mailing of local celebration, enjoyment, crack, and an international or national element to it, depending on who happened to be in town at the time. It's now going 31, 32 2 years, so we have our own Glastonbury.
And we
do it every August.
very good. So if I could just, I suppose, for me to sort of get a better understanding of who you are as a person, I suppose I'm going to ask you a question, sort of a long-winded question, and I hope you understand what I'm trying to get at by the time I get to it. So if you just bear with me for a minute, yeah. In 2008, I was involved in a near fatal experience or incident where an intruder broke into my house and stabbed me numerous times. And I suppose that traumatic experience, it set me on a spiral of self-destruction. My anger, I suppose, towards that person turned into rage. I was consumed by bitterness and hatred, resentment, thoughts of revenge were always there. And I suppose over the period of, say, 5 years, my mental health deteriorated to the extent that I tried to take my own life. I was carrying lots of shame that probably wasn't mine to carry. Until I reached out and got support and started to do therapy and counselling and lots of self-development on myself. So it's been well documented that yourself has, throughout your life, spent time on the run, you were incarcerated, you've seen the full horrors of what the conflict brought to people on this island. You yourself were shot at and tried to, you know, people tried to kill you. So how has you as a person dealt with that trauma? Because I know I didn't deal with it very well for a long time, and it destroyed me as a person. And because of the position you had within Sinn Féin, or the man of, you know, powerful man, were you ever allowed to feel vulnerable as a person, or did you allow yourself to feel vulnerable as a person? I don't know if that's, do you understand what I'm trying to ask?
Yeah. Well, let me first of all commend you for your bravery in speaking about your own situation, and also having the strength. And I know you've said you got support, and we all need support. Yeah. But well done to you for raising above it all and then helping other people who might have suffered the same plight. No, I'm as vulnerable as the next person. I mean, the worst thing that ever happened to me in my life, at a personal level, because you can rationalize many things, was the discovery that my father was an abuser. I have never come to terms with that. I've never worked that out. You know, that's just you know, beyond logic. And I know if you looked at it academically or looked at it through learning about the whole why people end up in that situation, it can't be rationalized. And by rationalized, I mean you can understand how it might happen, but it's just desperate sense of betrayal and so on. And in relation to all the other, you know, first of all the other incidents that you cited, like, I mean, this, all the windows in this house were broken in a grenade attack. I was shot. There were different other plots to kill me. But I wasn't on my own. You see, if it was just me, you know, this was a communal uprising. What happened in the North, particularly from 1969, was a popular uprising. Now, the Brits came in and they militarized it, and they sat on top of it and they squeezed it down. And it became, you know, very, very difficult to be involved in popular actions and mass actions because you were being shot or plastic bulleted or gassed and so on. But had it been just one of us, then, you know, you may have gone down under, and many people did, and many people are suffering from trauma, people who were injured or who saw terrible things or who ended up in prison for long terms. But my strength, if I have strength, I'm just a great believer in the empowerment of people. It is not worth my while to get out of bed in the morning to be involved in struggle unless that's about empowering people. You know, it has to be creating the conditions in which people can empower themselves. So for me, all my role models are the people, mostly women, and mostly middle-aged or older women, not exclusively so, who just sheltered people like me, protected people like me over all the years. And I couldn't walk the length of myself, and particularly in this community, without coming across these heroes and heroines, just, you know, and that they're rare in their families, and, you know, They won't get up and make big speeches, and they won't be on television, and they won't be getting applauded, but they're the people. And I see the same people in Ballybrack. You know, I know people in Ballybrack. I see the same people in Ballymun. I see them in Darndale. I see them down in Cork. I see them over in Limerick. You know, just that solid core of working class people who have a hope for the future, who want a better life for everybody. It isn't that they want stuff for themselves. They want everybody to, every child to have a chance, whether the child's, whatever the child's ability might be, and that people are treated fairly. And, you know, so that's where I draw my, you know, if I was feeling, and of course, the other thing is, I believe in what I'm doing. You know, I believe that we as a people should be free. I believe that everybody should have a home. You know, I believe that everybody should have the right to decent health services if we fall sick, including mental health services. I believe we should have a decent environment. I believe fervently in equality. You know, it's a tenement of living that people should be treated equally. And I don't, for the life of me, and I've lived all my life under British rule, see why anybody would want anybody rather than the people who live in the place to govern ourselves. I mean, why should some gobshite of an Englishman be taking decisions that are going to affect my life? You know, at least if we don't like Leo, we can get rid of him. You know, we can't. I don't even know the name of the current British Secretary of State. You know, why should he be taking a decision that's going to affect a woman down the street that has a kid with severe disabilities and can't get access or support or protection for that child? So I just, I believe in what I'm doing, and I also know that there's a cost, that if you put your head above the parapet, you are going to be vilified. You could get shot at, you know. Now, thankfully, those days are gone. I believe in what Sinn Féin's doing. I believe in the future, and I think we're we're no better than anybody else in the world. But you know, we're well able. The working class people of this country are well able to sort out our own lives and to build a better Ireland based upon equality than anybody else.
Okay, so if I could move on to the peace process, and you know, 99.9% I would hope of people on this island would say it's improved their lives immeasurably. And you were in, along with other people, you were an integral part of that process. And also, you've made Sinn Féin the power that they are on this island also. So, is there ever a time when Gerry now is sitting in the garden, and it's a sunny day, and reflecting on things, the radio's on the background, and he just has a little smile to himself and said, I haven't done too bad, you know?
Oh, yeah, of course. I don't think any one person should be given or should take credit for either the peace process, which is a slightly separate issue, or for the growth of Sinn Féin. We've had so many leaders, so many contributors, so many people who helped all of that. But I have been a firm believer for a very long time that you should always leave it better than you found it. So, okay, the conflict cost an awful lot of people their lives. And people are still carrying injuries to this day as a consequence of it. So I don't want for a second to minimize that fail to acknowledge the fact that there will be others who have a totally different take. Now, maybe I have the right to say what I'm saying because, you know, I was imprisoned. I was shot. My home was bombed. I lost many friends and family members. So, you know, if anybody has the right to take some satisfaction out of what we collectively have achieved, not one person or even one movement, but what we have collectively. So I do going back to what you said, Keith, about on a quiet morning, when I hear Mary Lou up on her hind legs, speaking to the system, I take pride from that she's our leader and she's moving it in the right direction. And when I look at my own grandchildren, who are all being reared in Irish, who all have a far better quality of life than my grandparents, or even my parents, and then when you go into working class communities like Ballybrack, and you know that it's still lacking in what should be normal wraparound services which allow people then to pursue happiness, then you realise that there's an awful lot more to be done, so you don't spend too much time glorying
but it is nice to reflect on that stuff you've done in life, isn't it?
Of course it is. I mean the photographs are that's Martin McGuinness, God rest him, and that's Chuck Feeney, and the guy beside him is Bill Flynn, and they were the people whose support we enlisted from Irish America, and there again is a sign of the connectedness of the Irish, that these folks that they're both very successful. Chuck's still alive, Bill's dead since. Chuck famously gave away all his wealth.
I know about a friend of mine, Lauren McCain, and done a podcast. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, amazing man. Self-made, very ordinary person. So they came in and helped. So there's the goodness. I mean, most people, I don't mean good in the goody-goody two-shoes sense, but most people are good-hearted, and most people, given the chance, their best side will show. And here's examples of people who took a risk as well, because their risk was on us, who they hardly knew.
Yeah.
But, there's Reid O'Hare. Reid's been living in Ballybrack. But Mick Nolan, who's recording this, sure, Reid half reared him. I have the Coyles and Lucio Brednock and Gordon and young Aoife and Emer and Owen and Mick O'Brien's from out in that neck of the woods, Brendan, Rita's partner, all wonderful, and I've left out about 100 people, all wonderful people trying to make things, trying to make things better for themselves and for their neighbours and for the future. And it's all about the future. I mean, one of the things, if you reflect on any of these great leaders, like Bobby Sands or James Connolly or Miriam McCracken back in the day, they were all about the future. I mean, they knew about the past. And they drew lessons from the past, but they were all about the future. They were all about a better place, better conditions, improving life, giving people the opportunity to fulfill their full potential. That's what they were all about. And I mean, Bobby, who was stuck in a prison cell and who died in a hunger strike, that's what he was about as well, about the future.
Okay, Gerry, so if we can move on to your last song, and it's from a guy called Liam O'Flynn, and it's called The Fox Chase.
Thank you.
gets the feet going all right, doesn't it?
This is actually based on a hound's chase from a fox. That's a pack of dogs. They're jumping over the hedges.
So
that's it. God rest. Yeah, is what was one of the famous pipers, and he famously went on to play with Planxty and with other bands, as well as playing as a solo artist. And he did a lovely collaboration with Seamus Heaney, where Liam played tunes and Seamus recited poetry. But there's a really, really fine, it might be Finbar Fury or someone, there's a really, really fine full 6 or 7 minute recording of the fox hunt or the fox chase, in which you hear the fox yelping, and the whole thing comes very, very much to life. And that's, you know, the pipes are, I think the pipes are our soul music. The pipes are, there's something in piping that that gets me. So as I said previously, although we hear lots of this music nowadays, I chose these three particular songs on the basis that, you know, they mightn't be played that often, and maybe it just encouraged somebody to go on to YouTube and listen to Liam Ogre, or listen to Christy, or listen to Mary Black, and so on.
And I was saying to Mick when I was listening to that tune, it very much reminded me of, say, with Braveheart when they were on the battlefield. It sort of makes you want to stand up straight, do you know?
You would have been the wee Irish man, Keith, in Braveheart. Remember the wee
Irish man? I think so. No, I'm about 6'4", Gerry.
The thing about that type of music, and I keep going back to it, and I keep going back to the likes of the Chieftains, even though I have, you know, I would play all sorts of music. I mean, I really, really, there's very little music that I don't like. But I keep coming back to it, and it's probably for the reason that you said, that it stirs you. You know, whether it's a dance tune, a martial air, a lamentation, you know, and the fact that these things were written, you know, like Tour de Lave was written 300 years ago, you know, and yet. You can, it's still played pop, you know. If there was a session on now, you know, somebody would be playing it just naturally. That's part of the great gift and joy of being part of a living culture. You know, this has been played in your kitchen, it's been played in the snub in the local pub, it's been played at a session on the street, it's been played by a busker. So it isn't something that's, you know, and that you have to go searching out. It's there wherever Irish musicians gather.
So let me ask you, Gerry, are you a bit like Alex Ferguson, or have you retired? You know the way Alex still has that presence around Manchester United. Have you retired? Are you able to chill out, or do you still have that presence around Sinn Féin, or do you let Mary Lou get on with it? Or?
Oh no! Well, could I stop her?
That's another thing. Yeah. No, but you know what I mean.
And I have no wish to. I haven't retired. First of all, but I have retired from the position I was in as the Uachtaráin or president of Sinn Féin. So that's Mary Lou's post and her office. But I mean, there hasn't been a day since I stood down that I haven't been working for Sinn Féin. I continue to work full time for Sinn Féin. I try to keep myself out of the media, you know, because there are public leaders there, and that's their job. And that doesn't decide that I don't do the occasional interview. I do the occasional interview, but I've no intention of ever standing for election again. So, you know, even if somebody wanted to talk to me, I think they're better talking to somebody who's in public and public leadership. So I work away quietly, diligently. And the big thing that I enjoy, I don't have the responsibility anymore.
Yeah.
So you have to be across everything. You have to be across everything. And you have to watch for everything, and you have to manage everything. And I remember a friend of mine, when he came out of prison, he said he wasn't going to come back into Sinn Féin because he didn't want anybody else running his life. Because, you know, you get into a schedule, you know, like,
yeah.
And I'm delighted to get talking to you, and it's very interesting listening to your take on life and on all these other issues. But, you know, if you were doing it from morning to night, and I did it from morning to night for almost 50 years, just to be relieved from that, to be able to say no, I'm not going to do that, you know.
But I didn't think I'd hear that coming out of your lips, Gerry. Just say no.
When I heard it was the famous Keith Kelly.
So can I ask you then, has it ever crossed your mind? Has it ever been whispered in your ear? How about being the president of the world?
It's an issue which keeps coming up, and I don't know where on earth it comes up from. Because there is absolutely no possibility under any circumstances. And, and anytime I've been asked, I have made that clear. I'm done with running in elections. I've done that from 1983, which is quite a long time. And you know, I'm content. I'm making a contribution. Hopefully it's useful. And I mean, I do think we're living in very dangerous, strange times. You know, the COVID is one example of a neglect of the global community to mind public health. And you know, I'm always mindful that these big conservative parties in power in Dublin fleeced the health services of workers and of resources and capacity and all the rest of it, and we're paying partly the price for that nowadays. But leaving aside those issues for a second, it's good not to have to do stuff with the same intensity as I used to. So how do I describe it best? I'm just as busy, but it isn't the same intensity of busyness, and it's quietly and it's in the background. And so, and I'm also doing a lot of writing. I do a podcast. I do a blog. I've a book at the publishers at the moment. I've published a number of books over the years. I have a new one, The Witness Tree. Hopefully it'll be out this year. It's O'Brien Press is going to publish it later on this year. So I'm happy enough in my life, and I also have time with my family, which I didn't have before.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. I recently myself became a grandfather, and it's like someone stuffed me with happiness. So what's your experience of being a grandfather? You know, you talk about all different ages and stuff.
Yeah, no, it's amazing. It's all the things that everybody ever told you about grandparenthood is true, absolutely true. And I think good grandparents, there's a subversive relationship develops because you're not the parent. So the child will expect you to conspire with them. will be manipulated, and so on. So no, it is a great joy, and just to be in the presence of, you know, from birth through to whatever age our oldest girl is. 21 now, And there's another one having their 16th birthday this week coming. The wee buck is 6, and then Anna in the middle is 12. So you see all the different personalities, all the different characteristics as they move from one stage of their lives into another stage of their lives. So it's as you have said, it's just you're stuffed with happiness.
Do you know what, Gerry? We're going to wrap it up. I have to say,
okay,
it's been an absolute privilege chatting to you, listening to your music, continued success in your retirement, which isn't retirement, get the dogs out later and go for a stretch. Yeah.
Right, and thank you, Keith, and thanks to Mick as well. But well done on what you do, and it's great that you're active in the community and that you're helping people, and the ability to give as you're doing it, and to both have the gift of that but also the willingness to do it. Well, fair play to you, and long may you prosper. And Ballybrick,
Ballybrick.
Good joke.
Stay safe, Gerry. Speak to you soon.
Take care, Carl. Thank you. Slán, lad. Bye-bye. Slán.